Good morning, everybody. And I'd like to welcome you today to Bruce Power's inaugural Bruce Power Medical Isotope Advisory Council meeting. A number of months earlier on in the year, we launched a Medical Isotope Advisory Council for Bruce Power. And earlier in the year, we were obviously in a much different world, not expecting the movement of the pandemic through Ontario and through Canada and through the world. And initially, our plan was to hold an annual symposium in July or August here in the Great Bruce, Huron County area. And essentially, that symposium would be a conference where we would bring together some of the leading experts in the development of isotopes, research and development into isotopes, and the use of isotopes for purposes all over the world, including sterilization, including medical treatments, medical diagnostic, agricultural purposes, and many other uses. Obviously, the world has changed, but what hasn't changed is Bruce Power's commitment to continue to advance our nuclear isotope agenda. And that's really what we're going to talk about today. So we've decided it, as opposed to having a full-day session, is to have a number of virtual sessions, because there was obviously a tremendous amount of interest in the public across Canada, across Ontario, within various sectors in this. And so moving to this virtual format is a way in which we think a number of people can hear from these experts, engage in this process, and really understand the opportunity before Bruce Power, our industry, the province of Ontario, and more broadly in Canada, in this space. So that's really the context for today's event. As with any Bruce Power meeting, I would like to start off with a safety message. Safety first is our number one value. And I think the most appropriate safety message today really continues to be around COVID-19. We see a scenario where numbers are increasing in terms of positive cases across not only the province of Ontario, but all across Canada. Many of it are referring to it as the start of the second wave. And essentially, the safety message that we have that I want to share with you today is really around what we can all do to make a difference. When this COVID-19 pandemic started, we did not have broad testing capability in either Ontario or Canada. We did not know how the virus could be beat, whether social distancing would work and physical distancing would work. We didn't have mass broader mask use. We didn't have a lot of the cleaning and sanitization techniques, and the list goes on and on and on. So the good news is that we know what to do to stop COVID-19. And in order to do that, it's really going to be, how do we exercise, all of us individually, those things that we know now, whether it's the utilization of testing, the utilization of masks, the distancing, the sanitization, all of those things that we know to do, we know how to beat this virus. And that's really, I think, the best safety message I can leave people with, because a lot of the patients that we're going to be talking about today who are undergoing cancer treatments, and I think medical isotopes is obviously a key player in that, those vulnerable populations, whether they're patients undergoing cancer treatments, whether they are senior citizens, whether they are people with other medical conditions, they have the highest degree of likelihood of, if they get the virus, to have significant challenges with that. So it's not only about stopping the spread in the community, it's also about protecting those individuals. I'd now like to kick this morning off and share with you a short video that really sets up Bruce Power's role in medical isotopes. And I think it's a great start to this morning's session.
In terms of one of the many things that Canadians are doing to really put their best foot forward and fight the COVID-19 pandemic. And that's an isotope called cobalt-60. Cobalt-60 is an isotope that is produced in our nuclear reactors at the Bruce B Nuclear Generating Station, located in rural southwestern Ontario, and the Pickering Nuclear Generating Station, based east of Toronto. The primary use of cobalt-60 is in the sterilization of single-use medical equipment in a lot of frontline healthcare applications. If we think of gloves that are used that are required to be clean and sterile, cobalt-60 is used to sterilize gloves and a range of other medical equipment. You can look around a doctor's office, you can look in a long-term care facility, you can look in a hospital operating room, anywhere that is really treating patients, and you'll see the presence of cobalt-60 everywhere through clean, single-use medical equipment. And just to put it in perspective, just shortly after COVID-19 was declared a global pandemic, Bruce Power announced the completion of one of its cobalt harvests. One cobalt harvest from Bruce Power produced enough cobalt-60 to sterilize 13 billion pairs of surgical gloves. So cobalt-60 has proven to be a tremendously important tool in the fight against COVID-19. It's something that Canada is doing, that we are leading in as a country, and that reliable supply of cobalt-60 from our nuclear reactors here in Ontario through the supply chain in Nordion are going to be more important than ever. The other area I want to talk about related to the supply chain of isotopes is a new initiative launched between the Nuclear Innovation Institute and the Canadian Nuclear Isotope Council. It's an initiative that's been launched to really look at our overall supply chain for isotopes. The one thing that's unique about isotopes is they only have a certain half-life, which means they're only effective in their use for a limited period of time. But the Nuclear Innovation Institute and the Canadian Nuclear Isotope Council, we're launching a study that is going to look at the robustness of the isotope supply chain and also look at some of the lessons learned from COVID-19 and determine how can we work with policymakers at the national and international level to ensure that we have a policy and regulatory framework that continues to ensure we can produce and manufacture and distribute isotopes. Because when it comes to patients and when it comes to frontline uses for these life-saving isotopes, it's really important that we have robust supply chains that we can count on, even in the most difficult of times.
So I think that really sets things up for today. And I'd now like to introduce our president and CEO, Mike Renchek, to really kick today off. Since Mike has been the CEO of Bruce Power back in 2016, you know, the expansion of what we're doing in medical isotopes has been a top priority for him to align our entire organization around the looking at both the investments we're making, the integration with our operations teams, the sponsorship and the support for the Canadian Nuclear Isotope Council. And we, you know, I'm sure one of the things that Mike is going to share with everybody is we recently changed our mission and vision statement as a company. And Mike has made medical isotopes and the fusion with nuclear power a key focus area for Bruce Power. So I'd like to pass it over to Mike to kick things off today. Welcome, Mike.
Hey, thanks, James. And I'd also be my pleasure to invite all the panel members here today. We appreciate your advice and how you're helping to guide us forward in our ventures. And I'd also like to thank Minister Walker for joining us here today. It's that stable policy perspective that enables us to venture into new businesses and make the investments that we're making. As Jane talked about, our vision is to power the future, and our mission is to provide clean, reliable, affordable electricity, life-saving medical isotopes, while strengthening our communities, protecting the environment, and building and securing the future. It's all about that brighter future that we're pursuing. You know, many people know us because we supply 30% of Ontario's electricity at 30% less than the average residential cost. We're the largest operating nuclear reactor site in the world. But we also make medical isotopes that save lives every day. And I'll spend more time talking about that. But the third aspect of it is one that we are in process with now. We're investing and performing Canada's largest private sector infrastructure project. And the end result of that will be to extend our plants all the way out to 2064. And what that means is we'll have a stable and long-term support for isotopes, not only now, but for many, many decades to come. So from a business perspective, we've actually restructured our company and we've formed a business development area now under the leadership of James Skoniak. And one of the primary focuses will be on the production of medical isotopes not only for Canada, but for the world, and not just in the short term, but for many, many decades to come. You see, presently, when Chalk River's reactor shut down some years ago, Bruce Power innovated and stepped into that void to be able to supply cobalt-60. And that low specific activity cobalt-60, as the video says, is used to sterilize more than 40% of the world's single-use medical devices. So if you think about that, if you go to the doctors or dentists anywhere in the world, there's a real high likelihood that that equipment was sterilized by an isotope made here in rural Ontario in the little town of Tiverton. We also innovated in the following years to look at how we could make high specific activity cobalt-60, and that's used to power the gamma knife, which is a technology that's non-invasive and can be used to treat brain tumors. It's also powering a new technology that we're bringing into Canada called gamma pads that'll be used for breast cancer treatments. It's also used for other forms of control for like Zika virus and other insect sterilizations. Our interest in this, though, is expanding. You see, that innovation and those partnerships that we've been able to build throughout the province and throughout Canada has really created a great network of companies, Nordion, Kinetrix, Framatome, Cameco. And with that, we are now exploring the advancement of a new production system that will be installed on one of our reactors in 2021. Upon working through that, making sure that we can use it effectively, we'll expand that to multiple units on a reactor and multiple reactors. That's a game changer in terms of medical isotope supply. You see, that will now have the scale and the reliability to supply medical isotopes at any time and with a reliable production schedule. And with that, we'll first pursue the creation of lutetium-177, which is used to treat prostate cancer as well as other radiotherapeutics. And we'll also just sign now with another partner company, BWXT, to look at the creation of the molybdenum-99, which is used in diagnostic imaging and disease detection. These are made in Ontario solutions, and they're made in Ontario through the innovation and creativity of the companies, the medical community, and the universities, and those partnerships that we've been able to form over the years. To that extent, we had an announcement between Bruce Power and Cameco a few weeks ago and the Nuclear Innovation Center a few weeks ago to create the next generation of nuclear center in the Nuclear Innovation Institute with a specific focus on advancing isotopes. Next slide, please. That's also enabling part of our vision, and our mission statement is to strengthen our communities. We signed a partnership with the Saugeen Ojibwa Nation to produce lutetium-177. And that's from a couple of perspectives. One, it's an equity investment that'll provide a return to the Saugeen Ojibwa Nation. But more importantly, it's an investment in saving lives by our communities. And we see that structure as being strong and sustainable well into the future for many decades to come. And with that economic opportunity and prosperity, will come the innovation and creation of new ventures and the ability to do new things together. Next slide, please. We're excited about this for a number of different reasons. Canada's leadership role in the global isotope supply has been well established over many decades, thanks to the Chalk River Laboratories. But as those have faded away, we've seen private sector entities like Bruce Power now step in to fill those voids and be able to work and establish partnerships to be able to move forward with this. When we look at medical isotopes as a business, it's quite an opportunity for Canada, it's quite an opportunity for Ontario, and it's quite an opportunity for rural communities like we have here in Grey Bruce and Huron County. You see, we see the medical isotope market in Canada growing to about $925 million by 2023. We see the size of the global market about 9.6 billion. And at that today, and that's expected to grow to about 17 billion in 2023. For lutetium-177 alone, once it can be secured and stable, we see a 10% growth in that market between 2018 and 2023. What that means is our ability to produce these isotopes at scale mean we'll have reliable and affordable treatments for many, many people. That'll unlock the creativity in the medical communities to explore new treatments and new solutions. And at the same time, it'll help economically in rural areas and really help to stimulate the university and innovation networks throughout Ontario. With that, I can't tell you how proud I am to have that under the leadership of James Skoniak in our company. He's doing a fantastic job, and I'll turn it back to James and let him talk about where we're going with isotopes.
Great. Thanks, Mike. It's a really exciting file. And you know, I think that direction coming from the top, I think really sets us up very well for success. I'd now like to welcome a special guest we have. But before I do that and share with you the panelists today, there's a number of individuals I'd like to recognize who are the members of the Bruce Power Medical Isotope Advisory Council. These are individuals who are globally respected for the work they do. We're honored to have them as part of our Medical Isotope Advisory Council. And since launching this, we've also had a number of individuals who will be added to this advisory council, which we'll be announcing in the coming weeks. The current members that we have on the council are Paul Wynn, who serves as the general manager for the International Radiation Association. That's a global organization that really represents the sterilization sector across the world. Kevin Brooks, who's the president of Nordion, our key partner when it comes to high specific activity cobalt 60 and low specific activity cobalt 60. Dr. Doug Borum, who's a professor and division head of medical science at the Northern Ontario School of Medicine. You're going to be hearing from Dr. Borum today. Dr. Steen Meiring, he's the assistant professor of radiation oncology at the Odette Cancer Center at Sunnybrook Health Sciences Center. Dr. Amit Singh Narkar, who's a nuclear medicine physician at Sunnybrook Health Sciences Center. You're going to be hearing from him today as well. We really appreciate him taking the time out of his busy schedule to join us. Dr. Arjun Sehgal, who's a radiologist and oncologist also at the Odette Cancer Center. Dr. Sehgal has been involved with Bruce Power and the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada for a number of years, in particular around the work, and you're going to hear more about this from Sunnybrook, on treating brain tumors using gamma knife technology. Susan Marshall, who is the president and CEO of the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada. Michael Barrett, who serves as the president and CEO of the South Bruce Gray Regional Health Center. Reason why Michael Barrett's participation is so important in this is we're based in rural Ontario, and a key element for us coming out of a lot of this work is what can we do to enhance rural health care and equal access for rural and remote communities. Dr. Rebecca Wong, who serves as a staff radiation oncologist at Princess Margaret Hospital at the UHN, and you're going to be hearing from Dr. Wong, and you know, had the opportunity to tour Princess Margaret with Dr. Wong, and she's incredibly passionate, and I think you're going to really enjoy what she has to say today. So those are the members of the Medical Isotope Advisory Panel. I'd now like to welcome the Honorable Bill Walker, who serves as the Associate Minister of Energy, but more importantly, Minister Walker, you serve as the MPP for Bruce Gray, Owen Sound, the second most beautiful riding in Ontario next to the riding of Huron-Bruce, but of course I'm biased. Minister Walker is not only a strong supporter of the nuclear sector, he's a significant advocate for Ontario's role in medical isotopes. A number of years ago, he was instrumental in bringing legislation forward to create Childhood Cancer Awareness Month here in the province of Ontario. And I should say September is Childhood Cancer Awareness Month. And also Minister Walker is recently a recipient of an award by the Canadian Nuclear Isotope Council for his public policy leadership. So Minister Walker is in Toronto today, joining us from his office. Thank you for joining us, Bill.
Thank you, James. Truly a pleasure to be here. To Mike, to the whole Bruce Power team, your council and Nordion, what you're doing with isotopes around the world is truly incredible and remarkable and making a difference in lives. I'm a proud Bruce County boy, as you've mentioned, of that little nuclear plant in Tiverton and all that you do energy-wise and isotope-wise. I'm a proud champion of Contero being a global leader in the supply of medical isotopes, and the collection of panelists that you've gathered today for today's event is truly reflective of that. Doctors Wong, Borum, and Signaker, you're truly an impressive group of speakers, and I look forward to hearing your thoughts and insights on emerging trends, treatments, and solutions for a range of global health challenges by using medical isotopes. As most people are already aware, healthcare providers and people around the globe look to Contero-made medical isotopes to sterilize medical equipment and increasingly treat cancers and tumors. As healthcare systems around the world face increased pressures due to COVID-19, the need for your medical isotopes is even more critical than they ever have been. Just recently, I had the pleasure and the opportunity to visit Bruce Power and Isogen's isotope production system mock-up at Framatome's state-of-the-art facility near Kincardine to see Contero-made innovation at its finest. Now, I have to tell you, I'm a proud guy of all of that. Once installed at Bruce Power's reactors, this new production system will deliver lutetium-177, an important medical isotope in the global fight against cancer. Minister Rickford, another strong advocate for Contero-made medical isotopes, and I are very proud of medical communities around the world will be able to continue to rely on necessary medical isotopes produced right here in Contero. And I know, James, when we were at that original signing in Southampton with Saugeen Ojibwe First Nation, I was really excited to hear the potential development, the innovation for other isotopes that will, again, have a significant and a profound impact on the healthcare of people around the world. So to all of you involved in isotopes and in Bruce Power, Nordion, and the council, thank you so much. I look really forward to being a part of today's session and learning more. And again, just heartfelt thank you. People really have to understand the value that you're providing through isotopes and how much nuclear technology and innovation are going to help us through COVID recovery and beyond. Thanks so much and have a great day.
Great. Thank you very much, Minister Walker. And, you know, I think that especially now more than ever that we're in a world of COVID-19 and, you know, it's amazing how much you start to appreciate and understand some items that you previously would have taken for granted when you're in a difficult situation like this. And I think, you know, I know you, Minister Walker, and the Premier can be really proud of the fact that here in Ontario, we're going to produce enough cobalt-60 this year to sterilize 20 to 25 billion pairs of medical gloves, COVID swabs, and you know, that's not only something we're doing to improve the lives of people here in Ontario and fight COVID-19, we're playing a global role in that. So I want to thank you very much for your support, Minister Walker. And now we're going to move on to our first panelist of the day. I think Mr. Remchek did a great job providing an overview of Bruce Power's isotope program, so I don't need to do that. What we will do is, as we're working throughout the day here, or sorry, throughout the morning, and a couple of these other sessions, what I'll be doing is sharing with people some of the items that that we're working on in these various areas. But I think the key message that I hope people will take away from this is actually also a learning experience for Bruce Power. We are bringing these experts to the table because of the work they are doing. And this work is informing our development. It's informing how we believe, as Mike mentioned, around starting with lutetium-177, you know, where we can partner, where we can make a difference. So this is as much a learning opportunity for us at Bruce Power as it is for everybody who's interested in being a part of this. So when you're hearing some of these presentations in this session and future sessions, you know, really look at it through that lens. We're trying to, you know, get into some areas that we may not have talked about before. Understanding trends, understanding what's important to patients, understanding where the world is going in these areas, and that's going to inform our strategy, not even necessarily in 12 months or 24 months, but 5, 10, 15, 20, 50 years into the future. And that's literally the time horizon we are talking about. I'd now like to introduce Dr. Doug Borum. Dr. Borum is an individual that we've done a tremendous amount of work with over many years. He's been instrumental in our work that we've done at the Northern Ontario School of Medicine in a number of areas, whether that is low dose radiation, whether it's safety elements around environmental protection. You know, Doug has done a tremendous amount of work with us over many years, and very recently we expanded our partnership with Dr. Borum to include, you're going to hear about Ontario's Nuclear Innovation Institute and the work that the president and CEO of the NII, Bruce Wallace, is doing there. And we recently expanded the partnership underway with Dr. Borum and the Northern Ontario School of Medicine to actually be a key element of the Nuclear Innovation Institute. So, Doug, I want to thank you very much for joining us here today. I still hear there's no snow on the ground in Sudbury, so summer is still here. And I want to pass it over to you. I'm really looking forward to your presentation and insights. What I would say to people is, if you have questions and you're watching, please feel free to send an email to me at james.sconyak, S-C-O-N-G-A-C-K, at brucepower.com. I'll do my best to maybe in between some of these sessions ask people some of those questions, or make sure we cover them in a different segment. So that's James, J-A-M-E-S, .sconyak, S-C-O-N-G-A-C-K, at brucepower.com. Shoot me an email if you have any questions. And over to you, Dr. Borum.
Thanks very much, James. It's great to be here. I really appreciate it. I'm looking forward for the next couple of minutes to talk to you guys about some of the work we've been doing, but most specifically, how we can ensure people that get injected with these isotopes or are exposed to radiation are actually safe. So from a radiation perspective, we can use medical radiation to, first of all, diagnose issues. And when I say diagnose, I mean by looking at various things that happen in our body. For example, we can look at structures, and the picture seen on the left is the first x-ray of the guy that discovered x-rays of his wife's hand, showing that he could see inside the body and observe tissue or solid structures inside. And that's a structural kind of diagnostic procedure. We can also look at function, and that's how we use isotopes for, and that is metabolic and biochemical pathways that go on in our body require the use of certain elements and atoms, and some of the isotopes we use will replace those, and actually we can actually image them using certain pieces of equipment. So for diagnostic radiation, we're talking about a number of things that people are very familiar with, like low doses of radiation come from dental x-rays, very low doses. We have DEXA scans looking at bone density, standard x-rays, mammography for breast cancer, CT scans for looking at three-dimensional tissues, positron emission tomography for looking at hotspots or tumor growth in the body, and of course, nuclear medicine for a number of other diseases that we look at in the body. So we just talked about diagnosis. We can look at certain things, but now we're talking about treatment. And if we're using radiation to treat, there's sort of three basic treatment strategies. One is an external beam, which has high-intensity radiation that will target precisely a tumor and basically kill the tumor with inside the body, and that's the top picture. We have a second type of technology called brachytherapy, which is where a very radioactive isotope source is inserted into the tumor or into the body, either using small seeds or hollow needles, and that source irradiates the target tumor at a very close proximity. And finally, the third technique is where, instead of using a solid source inserted or an external beam, we actually inject an individual with a radioactive isotope designed to target a particular type of disease. Interestingly enough, James talked about cobalt-60. Canada was the world leader in developing radiotherapy. Back in 1951, Harold Johns developed a thing called the cobalt bomb, and that cobalt bomb eventually became the granddaddy of all the radiation therapy machines we have today, and Canada was the leader in that. And there's an example of how an isotope like cobalt-60 can take a cancer like cancer of the cervix, which only had a 25% cure rate at the time, and jump it almost immediately to 75% cure rate. So it's a very powerful isotope. So from a nuclear medicine, we can use these isotopes to either diagnose something, to find a disease, or we can use it as a therapeutic agent, delivering the large doses to the target tumor or the target tissue we're looking at. So radioactive isotopes, I'm just going to give you a quick overview on them. If the picture on the left shows an atom, and an atom that can give off, depending upon the type of isotope it is, various types of radiation, give off alpha particles, beta particles, it can give off neutrons, it can give off photons in the form of x-rays or gamma rays. So depending upon the isotope you're using, you can have the ability to understand where the the type of radius you want and where it goes, and target certain things. Now on the right, I have a picture of, you've heard of lutetium-177. It's an example of how this isotope, which is the LU in yellow there, is attached to a peptide, which finds a particular target. In this case, that peptide is designed to find a receptor on prostate tissue cells. And that receptor binds, and then that lutetium molecule is carried into the cell so that the beta particles that come off of it can irradiate those little squiggly things, which is DNA. And DNA gets damaged by the beta particles coming off. But the nice thing about lutetium is that not only is it damaging the target tissue, it sends off a signal as a gamma ray, which a gamma ray camera can detect external to the body. So we can actually see where the disease is while it's being treated. It's a very powerful tool. So I'm going to get into now radiation risk, and I've only got a few minutes, but over our lifetime, we're going to be exposed to radiation from two main sources, natural background radiation and man-made radiation. That's a small circle on the right. And it's roughly 50-50 now. It used to be about 80% of our exposure came from natural sources, but because of the increased use of medical radiation, our overall lifetime exposure has increased, so it's about 50-50 now. If you look at the circle on the left, the pie chart on the left, you can see that of that man-made exposure, almost 90% of it comes from medical nuclear procedures. A very small amount, if you see at the top there, comes from the nuclear fuel cycle, less than 1%. So a lot of the radiation we're getting exposed to is coming from our medical community. So when it comes to radiation, the critical target for it is DNA. And DNA is found in the cell on the left, shows a blue circle. That's the nucleus of a cell containing all the chromosomes that are in there. And with humans, we have 46 chromosomes or 23 pairs. Those chromosomes are wrapped in a molecule called DNA. It's a double helix. And that is the target that radiation, there's the critical target for radiation when it comes to how we damage the cells or treat the disease. So this is a very interesting picture. On the right top panel is, it looks like a bunch of chromosomes, but they're labeled with a technique called G-banding. And that's how we used to be able to look at chromosomes and how chromosomes get damaged by DNA. It's a very useful tool to understand how much damage is being done by a radiation exposure. On the top left panel are the same chromosomes. It looks the same shape, but they've been now painted different colors. And each of the 23 pairs have different colors on them. And the computer will line that up and tell you, are all 23 pairs the same shape and the same size, and is everything normal? That's a normal cell you see there. If radiation comes in and damages, the computer and the technologists can actually tell how much damage is being done. And we use this technique to understand how much biological effects or consequences as the radiation exposure done to an individual. And we can use this tool in a clinic to see how patients are impacted by this. The problem is that people are afraid of radiation, and that's been my challenge for the last 30 years of understanding low-dose radiation. And that is, you know, things like this come out in the New York Times saying, are we giving ourselves cancer? And the whole idea is we're using so much radiation, you clearly have a physician in this cartoon holding some kind of diagnostic test with a stethoscope, and it's clear it's not giving a good message. And people are worried about all this radiation we're using more and more and more every year. It goes up about 5% in nuclear medicine and diagnostic techniques. Well, that risk that we're talking about is based on a model that we now know is flawed for interpreting risk, but we have to do the research to demonstrate what is the real model we use. And in this figure you see is called the linear non-threshold model. And there's a black line, and that black line represents risk associated with being exposed to large doses of radiation. Along the bottom line, it's the dose. And you can see that around 1, which is 1 gray of dose, the risk has been calculated using the atomic bomb survivors that you have a 5% increased cancer risk if you're exposed to 1 gray of radiation. But we don't get exposed to 1 gray of radiation during diagnostic techniques like CT scans and other isotopic techniques. Some will talk about, but the bottom line is below one, above 0.05 gray, we have no data. And so we extrapolate down to 0, and that's the dose range is what we're talking about in diagnostic and isotope radiobiology. So the little dotted line that dips below the line is another model that says it may not be linear to 0. It may actually have a negative risk at low doses. And that simply means it may not be that bad at all. In fact, it might be beneficial. So this came out several years ago in the New England Journal of Medicine saying that 2% of all cancers in North America over the next decade will be caused by CT scans. And that scared a lot of people. And they talked about children getting linked to cancer later in life to get a CT scan. And that was based on that linear non-threshold model they showed you where they were extrapolating down to doses where they had no real scientific data, but using that model to extrapolate. So in response to that, we published a paper almost right after in the American Journal of Physicists and Surgeons saying that cancer risk in North America may be reduced, not increased, but reduced by 2% over the coming decades because of low-dose medical radiation exposures. And that started a big debate. And we recently, just last year, published a paper that basically says reevaluation of the linear non-threshold model and showing that new paradigms in modern molecular studies, we have amazing tools today to study what's going on at low doses, and that the linear model is not appropriate to be used to estimate risk of people getting exposed to medical radiation. So this is a picture of a live mouse. It's been scanned with two different techniques. The skeleton you see is a CT scan, and the red and blue and orange is actually a PET scan where the mouse has been injected with fluorine 18, which is a radioactive type of sugar that goes throughout the body and is deposited where the cells are using a lot of sugar and are making a lot of energy. And we got a grant from the U.S. Department of Energy, also money from Bruce Power and others that helped us, NSERC, and that helped us do a large animal study to show, does diagnostic CT scans or isotope injection with PET increase the risk of getting cancer in a mouse model? Now, this mouse is a very cancer-prone mouse. It's been genetically modified so that anything can push it over the limit or the threshold to get cancer. So they're very sensitive to getting cancer. They lack a gene called the tumor suppressor gene. So we did this experiment. It was a four-year experiment, lifetime study. I don't have time to get into it. But in the end, we published a number of papers from that work, again, showing that multiple CT scans, they actually extend lifespan. They don't decrease lifespan in cancer-prone mice. We've also shown in the bottom paper that when you get injected with PET isotopes, if you're really cancer-prone mouse, your cancer risk doesn't go up. In fact, it had a positive effect on kidneys because there's a lot of the isotope gets deposited in the kidneys and it reduced kidney disease in these mice. Very interesting result. Change. Trying to get my slide to change. Maybe someone else can change my slide for me. All right. So, I'm going to back up. Previous. Sorry, I'm having troubles with my, okay. So one, I think there's a little bit of a lag here. So I apologize. So this slide here basically is a slide that demonstrates that we can look at the damage to people's chromosomes in their white blood cells. And white blood cells are typically the most sensitive cells in bone marrow to radiation exposures. This slide simply is looking at the chromosome damage caused in chromosome aberrations. And because I don't have a pointer, I can't point it out. But basically what it says is before you get a PET scan, you get injected with a PET scan, and 2 hours later, if we look at your chromosome, there's no chromosome. We can't detect any damage. Then if we take your cells and we irradiate them and give them lots of damage, as you can see, the line goes up, before you get a PET scan, and we do the same experiment after PET scan, the data is showing that if you get a PET scan, your cells, your white blood cells, actually become resistant to a large dose of radiation, so that the PET scan has done something to improve your cell's response to radiation. So real quickly, this is a busy slide, but we were asked to write an invited perspective on some data that came out in a large French study that said, if women got treated with radioactive iodine for treatment of thyroid, could they get pregnant in the next year? And would there be any consequences on the outcomes, the pregnancy outcomes? So a large study was done with almost 2,670 women. They got doses of radiation from the injection of iodine-131. It ranged from about 140 milligray for the first dose, which is a small dose, and that's sort of a systemic dose. But in some instances where, for example, thyroid tissue might have been thyroid cancer may have been located near the ovaries, the iodine, radioactive iodine would go to that area and give the ovaries more dose. So in some cases, it was estimated that even up to 1,000 milligray or 1 gray worth of dose to the ovaries happened in some women. The outcome of that study was simple. It said there were no increases in miscarriages, stillbirths, premature births, low birth weights, congenital malformations, early death, neonatal death. And there was no increase, in thyroid cancer in the children that were born from mothers that were exposed to radioactive iodine. And the researchers of this basically concluded that there's no epidemiological evidence to show, I can't even read it from here, due to radioactive therapy before conception. So it's a safe process. And we were invited to write, why would that be? Why would even some of these higher doses not cause an effect? And this whole paper is about explaining it from a radiobiological perspective, why it is safe. We've also published a paper. The interesting thing about radioisotopes and radiation is that about 10% of the population are actually sensitive to larger doses of radiation. And identifying those individuals is important when it comes to high-dose radiotherapy, like we would use in brachytherapy. Now, this is a picture of someone getting radioactive seeds implanted into their prostate. And we did a study at the Jura Vinci Cancer Center at McMaster, where we identified about 10% of the people that had a really bad reaction to this. In other words, their urogenital or their gastrointestinal tract was damaged by the seeds. Even though the seeds weren't put in there, the tissue around the prostate was sensitive. So we developed a technique and published this paper several years back that said we have the ability now to identify the 10% of people that could have adverse reaction to this, this therapy. So I think we can use these tools as we go forward, as we develop new isotopes, to better understand how we can protect patients and people. Finally, to end this, we're doing a study right now at McMaster University. It's currently underway, again, being funded by Bruce Power and the Nuclear Innovation Institute, where we've taken patients and we've used whole body or half body low dose radiation twice a week, just kind of like getting an x-ray or a CT scan twice a week to stimulate the immune system to see if we can actually help the immune system attack recurrent prostate cancer. And the results are looking very exciting. And the doses we're giving are very similar to the systemic dose you might get with an iodine-131 treatment or some other isotope that we're putting into the body. So showing that we're stimulating the immune system and actually preventing recurrent prostate cancer using this technology is very exciting for us. Finally, I want to acknowledge the fact that Bruce Power has been a main driver in this. The success of our research programs are recognized globally. We are recognized as one of the top research programs in the world for looking at biological effects of ionizing radiation. And again, that's due to the years of support by Bruce Power. And I'd like to thank him for that. And the second guy from the guy on the right is me, but the second guy from the right is Frank Saunders. And Frank was very instrumental. He had a vision about where we could take safety of patients and nuclear workers. And he helped us develop this program for the last 18 years. And it's due to his vision and in his legacy that we are today. So with that, I'd like to close and thank everyone for listening.
Great. Thank you very much, Doug. And I'm really glad you mentioned the late Frank Saunders, who passed away this summer. It's somebody we all miss. And I couldn't agree with you more. We would not be doing the work we're doing with you and your team at the Northern Ontario School of Medicine if it wasn't for Frank's leadership over many, many years. So thank you very much for that, Doug. And if you stay on, we may have some questions for you as we move forward. But I think, you know, the key issue with your presentation is something we hear very often is really people's fear of radiation. And the key takeaway for me is that, you know, radiation is something we understand and we know a lot about. Often as individuals, when we don't understand or know a lot about something, our natural reaction is to fear it. But within the medical community and the work that you and other experts are doing, it is understood. And in fact, it's not only understood, but it's something that is utilized and managed in a very effective way to really contribute to the modern healthcare outcomes that we have today. So thank you very much for that overview, Doug. I'd now like to introduce Dr. Rebecca Wong. You know, I had the opportunity to work with Rebecca over the last year since she became a contributor and a member of the Canadian Nuclear Isotope Council. She works does a lot of great work through Princess Margaret Hospital and University Health Network through the University of Toronto, and had the opportunity, along with the CEO of the Nuclear Innovation Institute, Bruce Wallace, to tour that facility. And I can tell you, they're just doing amazing work at Princess Margaret Hospital. But what I'm even more excited about is really what I think Dr. Wong is going to talk about, and that's a new term that we will start, I believe, 10 years from now, it'll be part of our vocabulary. It's something that's emerging called theranostics. Typically, when we think of isotopes in cancer diagnosis or treatment, we think of isotopes for diagnostics, detection, and we think about isotopes for treatment, therapeutics. And I think what Dr. Wong is going to talk about is what she calls theranostics, which is really a combination of both. So, Rebecca, I want to thank you very much for joining us today. I know you're incredibly busy, but I think folks are really going to be interested in your perspective on this. And of course, we're really excited from a Bruce Power perspective on lutetium and what that could lead to. So over to you, Dr. Wong.
Thank you. Good morning. Can you hear me okay? I hope so. So thank you for the opportunity to address this panel. My title, Patient First. Patient first, indeed, that is the guiding objective behind the journey that Ontario Health undertook with a group of investigators to address the access to lutetium-177 dotatate therapy for a unique group of patients, those suffering from neuroendocrine tumors. I have the honor of leading the Ontario study from Princess Margaret Cancer Centre, made possible with the amazing collaborations from our consortium sites at Sunnybrook, Jurovinsky, and London Cancer Centre. Next slide. Neuroendocrine tumors is a group of diseases that is classified as an orphan disease, meaning that this is rare and with all of its associated challenges in accessing care and discoveries for new treatments. The well-differentiated subgroup do share some common characteristics. Specifically, they overexpress somatostatin receptors. Next slide. Next slide. Somatostatin receptors, while present in normal tissues, are overexpressed in neuroendocrine tumors. This serves as a biological target where radiopharmaceuticals can be designed, such as lutetium-177 dotatate, so that they are attracted and tagged onto the cancer cells, injuring them preferentially while sparing normal tissues. Next slide. The lutetium story started back in 1985 when a Dutch physician, Dr. Kranich, recognized in a PhD defense the therapeutic potential of the somatostatin overexpression. It took about 10 years for radiochemistry and research to bring the focus to lutetium-177 dotatate, being the best radiopharmaceutical for the treatment of patients with metastatic neuroendocrine tumors. And as the field evolved, we actually found that this radioisotope can serve other diseases when appropriately engineered. Because it is a modality with unique challenges for manufacturing and treatment delivery, access has been the main barrier to widespread use and licensing for its use. Patients who need the treatment has to travel abroad, perhaps some limited access through the London Special Access Program, or for the majority do without. In 2010, Ontario elected to take an approach that is guided by evidence. They convened an expert panel, and I served on this, published recommendations, including building the Ontario trial that is currently ongoing and almost finishing accrual, as a way to provide access and to generate data that has the potential to ensure sustainability and long-term access. Next slide. In the meantime, there's been international efforts in this space, and the first randomized trial in the use of 177 dotatate in midgut neuroendocrine tumor patients was on the way, and its results published in 2017. It was a game changer. It shows, confirmed the previous single arm studies that there could be a significant improvement to patients, showing an impressive progression-free survival at 12 months from 11% without lutetium and 65% in patients who received this treatment. Escalating the need to understand the use of radiopharmaceuticals in the treatment of cancer. Next slide. The Ontario trial is unique in that we created the infrastructure to provide not just the therapeutics, but also the diagnostic. As James mentioned, theranostics exploits the somatostatin overexpression, tagging different radioisotopes to allow us to diagnose, which is the gallium-68 dotatate. And for patients who overexpress the somatostatin receptor, confirmed this way, going on to lutetium-177 dotatate. These did not exist in Ontario before. Next slide. Through the implementation of this trial, we brought together the capabilities of radiopharmaceutical manufacturing scaled it and increased for clinical application. We brought together professional experts that don't normally work together, nuclear medicine, endocrine oncologists, pathologists, radiation oncologists, to support the trial and the clinical delivery. We all created the clinical care infrastructure and wet workflow for the delivery of this modality, which did not exist or certainly not mature previously. I'll skip the next slide and move on to slide 9. Since a radioisotope has a half-life of 7 days, it needs to be manufactured for each of our patients as they receive their treatment. We have refined the relatively complex steps from manufacturing to transporting to patient delivery. The one step that is still limiting our potential is the access to the radioisotope. Currently, each week, it's flown in from Europe and Germany. And this challenge is also an opportunity that Bruce Power is addressing that would allow significant escalation of what we can learn and what we can do. Next slide. The other opportunities that we have established and continue to build upon is, first, establishing a multi-center process to perform individual isosymmetry, and second, linking administered activity to radiation dose absorbed, something that in the radiation oncology field we focus a lot on. By doing this, we can further improve the therapeutic ratio, i.e. improving response and reducing side effects. Next slide. Individualized dosimetry involves measuring the dose of radiation absorbed by the kidneys for each patient to determine how much radioactivity to prescribe for the next cycle. We established a mechanism to do this across multiple centers, quality assuring, making sure this data that is standardized across the sites and is uniquely available to our patients being treated here. Next slide. Skip the next slide and go on to next slide. We also exploited the mechanism to understand the dose that is absorbed by patient tumors. Here you see a mechanism where we, on the left, is manually identify the area of uptake, and on the right is an automated way to contour the tumors. Next slide. We confirmed that and generated data that there is significant variability across patients and within patients, the radioactivity and the radiation dose absorbed. It could be more than tenfold difference, providing an opportunity to better tailor treatments and potential responses. Next slide. We also generated some tantalizing data that suggests that if we can give higher doses, that the individualized dosimetry enables patients have a better chance of getting a response, as represented in the gray bar here. Next slide. Finally, we believe that all the work that has been done to date is not only for confined to setting the stage and implementing treatment for this group of patients, but rather it set the stage up for us to broaden the use of theranostics in other diseases such as prostate cancer and other biological targets that is flourishing in other diseases, lung cancer, breast cancer, kidney cancer, melanoma, etc. Next slide. With all the expertise around us, we've built the infrastructure, we can create the pipeline to test and educate the next generation of physicians. We're uniquely poised to build theranostic centers here and across the country. Next slide. Ultimately, we're guided by patient first, and I'll leave you with the words from one of our patients. You might not see the end. It says, "It is life-changing." Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Rebecca. I mean, just think, you know, I mean, I think the first time I heard your presentation was maybe over a year ago, and we were both invited with Pat Dalzell to a meeting with the Ministry of Energy. And I know we had previously met through the CNIC, but you know, every time I hear this, I get more and more excited. You know, and you know, at the end of the day, what's really important is that as this develops, that we develop a reliable supply of this isotope, because you know, if it takes off in the way that we hope it will, so patients have access to this, we don't want the supply of isotopes to be a limiting factor. So thank you very much for your leadership and that presentation. We really appreciate it. And we, from a Bruce Power perspective, we look forward to more work with you and UHN and Princess Margaret. So thanks very much. I'd now like to introduce Dr. Singh Nirkar. And you know, and similar to the previous two presentations, you know, I think you're going to be really impressed with the work that is being done at Sunnybrook. You know, and what always amazes me when we hear from these experts and individuals doing this great work throughout Ontario and throughout Canada is, you know, if you think about the size of Canada, our healthcare system, our population by any measure, and you know, compare that to what is going on globally, we're a very, very small country in the big scheme of things. But in areas like our panelists are talking about, it's really clear that in these areas, Canada and Ontario are leading the world. And individuals that you may just bump into in the hallway anytime you visit one of these institutions, who may be unassuming and you see them as you know, part of the broader team of these facilities. What's amazing when you hear these stories is just the amazing global work that they are doing. And you know, and sometimes as Ontarians and Canadians, I think it's a great thing. We're very humble, but this is just an area of excellence that I think we should all be really proud of. So I would now like to welcome Dr. Singh Nirkar and turn the floor over to him. And I really appreciate him taking the time out of his busy schedule to visit us. I know you're a really busy individual, but you know, I think folks are really going to enjoy what you have to share with them. So over to you, and thanks again.
Thanks, James, for the introduction. I'm delighted to be here. I'm excited to talk to you about medical isotopes and how I think they're transforming cancer treatment. Next slide. So we have to think about, you know, what is it that we're trying to do in healthcare in general these days? We realize that a one-size-fits-all model just doesn't work. The more we find out about patients, the more we realize that they're different. And they're different along many dimensions. So if you consider the social determinants of health, you know, what is their education level? What is their built environment? What is their socioeconomic status? What are their tendencies? So if you, for example, were to prescribe some medication to a patient, would they be compliant? Would they be willing to take it? So I'll show you that medical isotopes may in part solve some of these problems, but I think mostly medical isotopes will help to deal with the biological viability. And here's how it's getting done. Next slide, please. So over the past few decades, we've realized, you know, how variable patients are. We've understood the variabilities in patients themselves and also in the cancers. And so, you know, on the right-hand side, I have a graphic showing all the different homes. And so what that is, you know, now we know more about genetics, physiology, anatomy, what proteins are expressed. And this kind of gets us closer to the vision of precision medicine in terms of figuring out exactly what is wrong and targeting that specific process. You know, how are we doing this? You know, the first problem is detection, figuring out what is going on. So because of this understanding, we have better blood tests, better genetic testing, and we have better imaging biomarkers. And medical isotopes play a large role, as you heard in the previous couple of talks. Medical isotopes help us with diseases and more appropriately target them. Now, you know, all this stuff is quite expensive when it first develops, but, you know, more recently we've kind of had broader access to these agents. The economics have improved and they've dropped the barrier to access, which kind of sets the stage for targeted treatments. Next slide, please. So let me show an example. Let's recognize the variability in between the patients. So these are a couple of men with prostate cancer. They were treated effectively, but now on surveillance, they have a rising KSA level, which is, you know, a marker in the blood that tells us that, you know, there may be something going on. they were imaged with conventional imaging, bone scan, CT scan, and you know, there was basically no disease detected. And so you're left with a problem. You have these couple of patients, you know something is going on, but what do you target? So, you know, they may have been placed on a surveillance approach, which is kind of just, you know, watchful waiting, or they may have been treated locally in the prostatic bed and surrounding tissues in hopes of getting the cancer that you may not be seeing on the available imaging. But now we have better tools. So these are PSMA PET scans, and these are this is a marker that targets prostate cancer cells. And so you see these patients are quite different. In the first patient, on the left-hand side, you see a focus that's in the iliac bone. So it's a skeletal metastasis, and it's a solitary focus, which may benefit from local therapy. On the right-hand side, our second patient shows that he has multiple areas of metastatic disease. So two very different patients that we may not have been able to distinguish before. And this is all due to the diagnostic capabilities of medical isotopes that target the tumor specifically. So the next step is, you know, what if I told you that we could turn these diagnostic agents into therapeutic agents? So, you know, and that is the goal of precision medicine. We know that the agent that we just used to image this patient is actually targeting the cancer cells, and we can make it more energetic, you know, relabel it with a medical isotope that delivers a higher radiation payload to actually destroy those cancer cells. Next slide, please. So here's a basic cartoon. It's obviously much more complicated than this. But if you look at the yellow radiation symbol, that represents a diagnostic medical isotope. And I've just colored a different color. If you change it to the blue one, you know, it would be one that delivers a higher radiation load to the local environment where it's deposited. And you basically use the same delivery vehicle, which is that hexagon. So that's the drug that gets it to our target. And so in this way, we can turn our diagnostic agent and turn to therapeutic agent. That gives us tremendous confidence, because if we're able to see the malignancy, we can then transform it into a therapeutic agent and know that we're going to have a very effective delivery of radiation to those areas. Next slide, please. So here's a treatment example. So again, these are PSMA PET scans. On the left-hand side, you see a patient who has diffuse bone metastases. And after a couple of treatments with cocktail of lutetium-177 and actinium-labeled therapies, the patient basically has, there's no tumor seen. And why has this happened? Because we've targeted the malignancy. And the great thing about these targeted therapies is that there's little damage to the surrounding tissues. Next slide, please. So this transforms the patient experience. You know, certainly we're treating the cancer, but we have to think about overall patient health, right? And these factors are important. You know, they have little or no side effects. They have reduced hospital stays because of this. The treatment durations are quite short, so it's convenient to the patient. And, you know, there's decreased out-of-pocket costs, like parking and staying at hotels and the cancer centers. You know, all these things are very important. All these things, you know, if you've ever, you know, known someone with cancer, you know, they are already quite, occupied with their primary disease. And to reduce these other factors really improves their overall experience and health. Next slide, please. So why are we talking about this now? So there is this incredible drive to personalize medicine, to develop precision medicine. We have a better understanding of biomarkers. They're less costly, they're reduced barriers to access, we set the stage for targeted therapy. We have better science. Radiochemistry has evolved tremendously over the past few decades. These kind of things would not be possible before. There's better radionuclide production, as we've heard earlier. We have increased capability to synthesize these treatment agents at a high enough quality to administer safely to patients. And I think one of the more important factors really has been the publication of high quality evidence. This has really been a problem in this space, certainly over my career, where there just hasn't been enough buy-in. And that's just because we have not published the appropriate evidence. Next slide, please. So this has changed dramatically over the past 10 years. So, you know, these are a couple of articles in the New England Journal of Medicine, which is a high impact journal, which the broader medical community reads. So if you look on the left-hand side, this is a radium-223 treatment for metastatic prostate cancer. Now, this is available widely. We certainly do it at our center, at multiple centers in Ontario, in Canada, and around the world. So this is game-changing. Dr. Wong, you mentioned the second article, lutetium-177 dotatate for the neuroendocrine tumors. So all these things, what they do is that they increase the awareness of medical isotopes. It's trusted evidence that permeates medical communities and practices. it spurs novel investigations in medical isotope treatments, because if you have confidence in the modality, then you may want to investigate new methods of therapy, and it accelerates demand. Next slide, please. And you can see this by the activity in the literature. So these are publications per year in the literature, and we have beta therapies and alpha therapies, and you see the publication rate is accelerating. So, just kind of switch gears a little bit into the economics. So considering the rising interest and therefore the anticipated demand for medical isotope therapies, how might we take this further from healthcare and patient transformation to an economic transformation locally and across Canada? We first have to consider the opportunity in front of us and then assess our local capabilities. Next slide, please. So the market for medical isotopes is growing. It's a multi-billion dollar market for all medical isotopes, that's diagnostic and therapeutic agents. So the total addressable market will only increase with time. And I think what's gonna happen because of the recent activity is that the demand for medical isotopes will rise. It's been rising at about 5% per year, and I think that's gonna accelerate. But I think that the demand for therapy, for therapeutic isotopes, is gonna accelerate at an even greater clip. So this provides an economic driver for accelerated development. Let's think about prostate cancer. I showed you a few prostate cancer patients. There are 1.3 million new cases of prostate cancer per year globally, and about 400,000 deaths. Many of those men would benefit from these diagnostic and therapeutic agents. So, let's think about, how can we be successful locally? Next slide, please. So if you think about at least the Ontario setting, we have pretty much the entire medical isotope therapy value chain, right? We have the research and development through universities and public and private partners, medical isotope production, which is now increasing, rare pharmaceutical synthesis, distribution, of course, treatment facilities. So having these capabilities result in a strong ecosystem for development. And I think we have an opportunity to develop another strong economic cluster in Ontario. We have the opportunity to have a strong system through co-location of these different capabilities, cross-reactivity, and the opportunity to develop new ideas and businesses. We've already been successful, at least in Ontario and other domains, such as artificial intelligence, regenerative medicine with stem cell therapy. This kind of ecosystem and value chain will help us retain talent, develop new compounds, and really compete on a global scale. This is really a global market. For our patients, we would also have a stable supply of medical isotope therapies. This has been a recent problem, and I think to shore up that supply would be quite beneficial. And in terms of the healthcare system, these kind of agents help us treat disease earlier in the process, which reduces the downstream load in our health system. And a final point I'll make is that, through developing a strong capability in Ontario, we'll be able to contribute globally, on a global scale, to patient health everywhere. So, things to ponder. I think it's a very exciting time to be in this space and very interested to see how things develop. So thank you for your attention. That ends my presentation. Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you very much. That's incredibly exciting. And, I think it fit really well with the sort of the broader narrative of today. So now what I would like to do is move into some questions. And we have a couple of questions online. And so what we'll do is we'll start covering those off. And I'm going to start with the first question, which has just been sent over to me by text message here from Andrea Armstrong, who looks like she's from McMaster University. And so thanks for your question, Andrea. And the question is to Dr. Wong. And that question is Dr. Wong, are you also looking at Y90 in the clinic? Would you expect this to have improved or complementary patient utilization profile to TCM-177 due to its higher energy beta particles as an example for treating large tumors? And actually, I'd be happy to open that up to the other panelists after Dr. Wong, because I'm sure there'll be other perspectives on that.
Hello. Not specifically, although Y90 for the use of intra-arterial injections to treat hepatic cancers is offered with special access for selected patients. But using radiopharmaceuticals in combination is a strategy that I think is very exciting. Using it in combination with immunotherapy, another targeted therapy, I think also strategies that we would like to be able to explore.
Right, and if I'm not mistaken, Y90 is primarily used for, let me take a look here. So it looks like it has similar, is it similar treatments to lutetium-177, Rebecca? Is it liver cancer, kidney cancer? Like what would you typically use Y90 for?
I don't personally use it, but I do know that it's being used for liver cancers and including neuroendocrine tumors.
Right, I think one of the important points here when we're thinking about isotope production, you know, it's really exciting, you know, learn more about the different isotopes used for diagnostics and treatment than I ever thought. And I think a key, and Mike talked about this in his introductory remarks, but really what we're trying to do at Bruce Power is establish a delivery system that has access to a neutron source. So lutetium-177 was where we wanted to start for obvious reasons that we've talked about today. But our expectation is once we've been able to demonstrate lutetium-177, we now have a delivery system that has access to a neutron source. And so for you know, we have some isotopes you have to make in a reactor because they're neutron rich, and you have some isotopes that you use an accelerator for. And so our expectation over time is that this delivery system, we hope, will be an anchor for all of those neutron-rich isotopes and provide, as different treatments come available and demand for isotopes comes available, that, you know, we're not developing new supply sources. We're using this as a flexible model. Dr. Singhaker, just interested in your perspective on that, the question on why 190 compared to lutetium-177, and just, you know, what would be really interesting is what other isotopes, like if you're sort of looking at it from a Bruce Power perspective and thinking about those neutron-rich isotopes, what other isotopes should we be thinking of that maybe we're not? Obviously, we have to start with lutetium-177, but what other isotopes should we be thinking about?
Well, on the yttrium-90 piece, you know, it is another beta emitter like lutetium-177. It's being used in nuclear medicine, as Rebecca said, for liver tumors for targeted therapy. We've also used it in an agent called Zevalin, which is the therapeutic agent for lymphomas. It hasn't really gained that much traction. It all depends on the chemistry, our ability to radiolabel these agents. So, you know, there are a whole host of rare nuclides that we can consider, but, you know, it comes down to the chemistry. It also comes down to, you know, what is it that you're trying to do with the treatment? So, you know, all these different beta therapies have different ranges. And so, you know, it depends on the overall structure of the tumor, you know, what is the density of cells, and then basically picking the correct therapeutic agent, you know, for that. So certainly, I think most of the activity now is in lutetium-labeled agents. So, I think Bruce Power is in good shape. But I think it's really going to depend on how we develop the different chemistry to radiolabel these radionuclides.
No, that's really helpful. And Doug, I know, Rebecca, I think you had a question for Doug, actually, that you had sent me.
Yes. Do you want me to ask the question?
Go ahead.
Okay,
you don't want me trying to put it in James speak or between two scientists. It's not going to make any sense.
So I was very interested in hearing about your work in malignant potential. In this space, given the way that theranostics works, it makes a lot of sense to bring it closer to the earlier stage disease for adjuvant patients, for example. But every time we think about it, we are worried about second malignancies. So my question is, are there any translational endpoint, animal experiments, or choice of radioisotope that could help us estimate what the risks are until we get the clinical trials and long-term studies to prove it one way or the other?
Yeah, there are a number of models that we've been using over the years and others in, across the globe. I think there is actually some studies on secondary cancers caused by the primary treatment. It's interesting that if you're combining radiation in combination with other chemotherapeutic agents, that the secondary cancer risk goes way up. But when it comes to the primary treatment only being radiation, there's pretty limited evidence that says, at least for external beam where you get high doses in one area, you're going to get scattering and what we call ascopal effects. But we're not seeing increased cancer risk in tissues surrounded by areas that got high dose radiation. So as long as it's radiation, when you start combining other chemicals in there, other chemotherapeutic agents, it changes the way the cells can respond. And I think the question you just brought up is excellent, because this is where we're going to have to go in the future, because before we start injecting some of these new things into patients, we're going to need to be pretty sure how safe they are. And I think we have a lot of opportunities now looking at some of these models, but a lot of what was mentioned with the omics is going to help us a lot understanding who's going to respond best. So yeah, it's going to be a really exciting time for the next little while. And the tools that we're developing every year are phenomenal to me. In fact, that's up to the young smart guys right now to figure out.
Well, that's great. Well, I know we're short on time. And what I really wanted, and I appreciate Minister Walker has actually been joined in and tuned into this whole session. So thank you very much for that, Minister Walker. And I can tell you at both the provincial level of government, right up into including the Premier, other members of Cabinet, Minister Walker mentioned Minister Rickford, Minister Lisa Thompson. I mean, there's a lot of interest on this at the provincial level. And also at the federal level, with Minister Seamus O'Regan, a tremendous amount of interest and support in this. And I guess, recognized funding is always a key consideration. But really what I want to do is sort of go around the table, and maybe I'll start with Amit. And, you know, if you were giving, maybe this puts you on the spot a little bit, but if you were giving Bruce Power one piece of advice on what we should be focused on, and if you were giving levels of government also a piece of advice on what they should be focused on as somebody who does this every day, what is your advice to Bruce Power and what is your advice to policymakers? And I'll go around the table as we wrap today's session up. What advice do you really want to leave people with and around both the challenge but also the opportunity here?
That's a good question. I think we have the science and I think we have the production capabilities. So, as I said, I think this ecosystem effect is very important. And so in those other areas that we've had early success with, such as artificial intelligence, regenerative medicine, there's been a concerted effort to kind of develop this industry within Ontario. And I would say, on the governmental level, I think, there should be stimulus in terms of developing medical isotopes as well, because, it is a large market opportunity. We do lose talent to other jurisdictions. So if we're able to keep that talent and keep that innovation going in Ontario, I think we can really compete on the global scale. The other thing would be to reduce the amount of regulatory burden on new investigators, universities, private sector develop these compounds. And I think once you kind of, grease the wheels in that way, I think we can be very successful here. So I think Bruce Power should definitely, is already playing a role, it seems, in that process. And I think, further engagement with government and local partners would be very beneficial for us to develop this.
Great. That's a great perspective. Dr. Borum, your thoughts on advice for Bruce Power and advice for levels of government?
Well, James, clearly the success that we've had partnering with Bruce Power has shown that one of the best ways to get recognized as international leaders is to have universities partnering with industry. And Bruce Power's partnered with industry already, but there are levels of federal funding that can be used to leverage Bruce Power money. And partnerships like that is what really make things go forward. But I think what you really need is you need some champions to spearhead this, that they're because of today in the academic and the research world, it's so hectic. I would recommend that Bruce Power establish one or two industrial research chairs or academic research chairs that specifically focus on the safety and the development of various new isotopes. And that being said, a lot of that money will come from government, and I do agree with the regulations. it's very difficult to get a clinical trial going now with something new, even something as simple as having patients take a nutraceutical that's designed as a radioprotectant. Ethical review boards are getting very tough on things. So we need to figure out a way to get some of these things from bench to bedside without all the regulatory barriers and other issues that we deal with.
That's helpful, Doug. And you know, I also think, you know, earlier on you talked about the work that NOSIM is doing with the Nuclear Innovation Institute. And I think, you know, one of the reasons why we established the Nuclear Innovation Institute and our president, CEO Mike Renchek, is the chair of that institute, is exactly for some of these kind of things and how we establish that network and ecosystem. So I think that's great advice. I know Bruce Wallace is listening. So Dr. Wong, you get the last word of advice for Bruce Power, and our president and CEO is on. So he's listening, and I guarantee you, whatever you guys say Bruce Power should be doing, we're going to all be getting a text message from Mike after saying, let's get going on this, because he's a big supporter of it. So last word on what do you think Bruce Power should be focused on, and also advice for government?
I think for this field to continue to blossom and bringing the bright minds together, funding is the main issue, and it doesn't have to be huge amount of funding, but a forum where people can gather their expertise and come up with ideas and have the potential of getting funding. So be it funding platform through Bruce Power or in collaboration with a public funding agency, focusing around development of radio pharmaceuticals and therapeutics, I think will galvanize the space.
No, that's great. Thanks very much, Rebecca. And I think you all, you know, one of the themes that I think you all touched on is really first and foremost, developing that supply capability. And you know, if we have the ability to supply the isotope in Ontario at a reliability and a volume and an agility that nobody else does, I would also note our friends at Ontario Power Generation are just doing awesome work when it comes to the production of molybdenum 99 at Darlington. So, you know, it's great to see the industry coming together. And of course, we think broadly in the nuclear industry, you know, we have a longstanding, very successful facility at McMaster University. And while the Chalk River facility is now shut down, you know, if we go back 50 years in Canadian history, you know, some of the greatest brain power and innovation really rests in a lot of elements of that organization. So I think we, you know, a few kind of themes here. We need the supply first and foremost, and we're going to start with lutetium, and we're going to focus on that. It sounds like the ecosystem is really important, and the comment that was made, I thought, was spot on around let me call it the brain drain, for lack of a better term here. Is, you know, we can often focus on technology and assets, and we have that in Ontario, but the real capability in Ontario is within its people. And so, you know, how do we create that ecosystem and alignment to do that? And certainly I know Bruce Power is committed to playing a role in that. I think the final thing for government is, you know, the key messages is that, you know, I think Rebecca, it's where you touched on is, you know, it doesn't. There's not huge asks, so to speak, in terms of government funding. There's some things we can do around red tape reduction. And, you know, you have three doctors on here, and they're not going to reduce any red tape that's going to harm anybody. So it's coming from people who have the patient in mind first. But, you know, what can we do on that red tape reduction? But I also think, too, there's no governments around the world anywhere who are embracing isotopes as a strategic sector. And I think just some of that advocacy, and I know Minister Walker's on, and you know, really declaring this a strategic sector for the province of Ontario and Canada, I think what it can do is raise the awareness. So as funding programs are getting developed or mechanisms around infrastructure investment and those things, we're thinking about it from an isotope perspective. One of the things I can tell you with from a Bruce Power point of view is that we have often found that There's very few programs or initiatives that are really structured around isotopes. And we're always struggling to find a way of how do we fit isotopes into something. And so, you know, so I think that'll have a lot to do with that. But look, I really want to thank everybody for your time today. This is the first of our medical isotope advisory council. As I mentioned, we're going to be adding some additional members. And you can see why I was excited at the start of this. We have some really amazing people here. We are going to take all of these elements from a company perspective and use that to inform our strategy because, you know, it's experts like this that we need to listen to. And as I always like to say with a hockey analogy, watch where the puck is going. So I'm going to wrap up today's session at that. I promise we'd be complete before 10:30. I don't think we'll be working with the panelists to make their presentations available. And we will also be posting this on the Bruce Power website. And we look forward to announcing the date of our next Isotope Advisory Council live event. Obviously, once we're through this pandemic, we look forward to an in-person symposium. But we know we can't do that for good reason, and we're not going to let it stop us from making progress. So I want to thank everybody for their support and look forward to the next session. Take care and have a safe day.